Thanks very much, Mr. Chairman and Mr. Bernanke. Thank you very much for being with us. I'm going to try to be as brief as I can. I think I have three questions which I would appreciate your answering. Number one, first one deals with conflicts of interest at the Fed. As you know, Jamie Dimon is the CEO and chairman of J.P. Morgan Chase, which is the largest financial institution in this country. During the Fed bailout, if you like, when $16 trillion in low-interest loans over a period of time were given out to every financial institution in this country, J.P. Morgan Chase received over $300 billion of those loans. The American people, I believe, perceive a conflict of interest when you have, among others, the head of the largest financial institution in America sitting on the New York Fed, which is presumably supposed to be regulating the Fed, regulating these financial institutions. I think many people, including myself, see this as a situation where the fox is guarding the hen house and that we need real reform in the Fed to make sure that it's representing the middle class and small business of this country rather than just Wall Street and the big money interests. Would you be supportive of legislation that I've introduced which says that representatives of financial institutions, not just Mr. Dimon, but others, get off of the Fed and they be replaced by folks from the general public?
Well, you raised, Senator, you raised an important point, which is that this is not something the Federal Reserve created. This is
right.
This is in the statute. This
yes.
Congress in the Federal Reserve Act said this is the governance of the Federal Reserve, and more specifically, that bankers would be on the board. And
six out of nine.
Sorry?
Six out of nine in the regional banks are from the banking industry.
That's correct, and that is in the law. And,
right.
And what we have done is try to make something useful out of that. What we've done is, first of all, we have taken a lot of actions to negate conflict of interest. And under Dodd-Frank, the GAO did a comprehensive study, as you know, of our governance, did point out some appearances of conflict.
I know, I wrote that provision. I am familiar
yes,
with
it. Yes, and I congratulate you. But it also found that there were no actual conflicts of interest. Because there is a firewall that so that the bankers do not have any information or ability to influence supervisory decisions. I'll answer your question, though. Your question is that Congress set this up. We have tried, I think we've made it into something useful and valuable. We do get information from it. But if Congress wants to change it, you know, of course, we will work with you to find alternatives.
Okay, thank you. And I think that is something, you're quite right. This is something that Congress established a long time ago. I think it's time to change it. My second question is, in America today, we have the most unequal distribution of wealth and income of any major country on earth, worse than in any time in our country since before the Great Depression. You got 400 individuals owning more wealth than the bottom 150 million Americans. You got the top 1% owning 40% of the wealth of America, while incredibly enough, the bottom 60% own only 2% of the wealth in America. The last report that I've seen in terms of income, not wealth, suggested that in 2010, 93% of all new income from the previous year went to the top 1%. Now, my question is, we can talk about economic growth all you want, but to the average person, it doesn't mean a damn thing if all of that new income is going to the top 1%. Do you believe that we can see an expanding middle class if we continue to have that kind of grossly inequitable distribution of wealth and income?
Well, I think it's not so much a question of bringing down the top 1%, it is bringing up the lower 99%. The question is, how can you strengthen the middle class? How can you make middle class incomes higher and more secure? This has been as you know, a trend that's been going on for 35 years, and it's related to a lot of factors, including globalization, the technical change, which has made a high school education simply less valuable. So I would be very much in favor of measures to strengthen the middle class and help average American do better, and approaches like education and so on would, I think, be very constructive.
Last question.
Yeah.
You have six of the largest financial institutions in this country, the large Wall Street banks, that have together assets equivalent to 2/3 of the GDP of the United States of America, over $9 trillion. You have some folks on the New York, on the regional feds, and I and some others beginning to talk about the need to break up these huge financial institutions, which have so much economic and political power. The top six banks write 2/3 of the credit cards in this country and half of the mortgages. My suspicion is if Teddy Roosevelt were here, a good Republican, he'd be talking about breaking up these financial institutions. How do you feel about the need to finally break up these large financial institutions that have so much economic and political power?
Well, I first comment that a lot of these people saying they want to break up the banks are not very specific. Does that mean making them a little smaller? Does it mean making everything community banks? I really would like to see a plan that clarifies what is really meant by that. The Dodd-Frank Act put forward a strategy for ending too big to fail. I think it's incredibly important to end too big to fail. That strategy involves taking away the advantages of size. It means that banks will be allowed to fail, but through a safe method that will avoid the effects on the broader financial markets through the orderly liquidation authority that Dodd-Frank created for the FDIC. It means that large banks will pay, will have higher capital requirements, tougher supervision, will be subject to a whole set of rules that that smaller banks will not face. I will guess that if the size of banks is basically motivated by a too big to fail motivation, as we take that away, that market forces themselves will make it attractive for banks to downsize, rationalize, and so on. I would add an additional tool that we have from the Dodd-Frank is the so-called living wills, which require banks to give us information about their very complex structures. One approach would be to ask banks, for the purposes of being able to be brought into receivership if necessary, is to simplify their structures to avoid these very complex, interconnected types of situations that I think are as much a problem as sheer size.
Okay, thank you very much.